and treatment. Treatment programs have just expanded tremendously over the last few years when it comes to adolescent sexual offenders. Number of treatment programs as of the year 2000 is 249 community-based treatment programs, and I'm sure that's doubled by now in 2006. 115 residential treatment programs, and that's just in the U.S. When we look at worldwide, that there are 1,000 treatment programs, and again, I wouldn't surprise me if that has doubled by the year 2006. Guidelines for working with youth. Well, we have to begin with a comprehensive assessment. I cannot emphasize that enough. I get very concerned just in the general types of mental health practice that we have is how many of our colleagues jump into treatment without doing an assessment, without developing a treatment, a written treatment plan that's then gone over with the people who depend upon us to be knowledgeable in guiding their healing and recovery. So not only do we need to have a comprehensive assessment that culminates into a written report with adolescent sex offenders, we really need to be doing that with everyone that we're working with and not just jump into treatment and then wonder why therapy isn't working, okay? Or why people drop out, by the way. I get a question like that a lot. And my first question is, did you do a comprehensive assessment? Did you develop a written treatment plan that then was gone over with the individual who came for your care? And a comprehensive assessment is going to focus on five things immediately with the adolescent, and that's offending patterns, which is the cycle of abuse. What cycle of abuse did they establish in order to commit their sexual offending? Deviant arousal patterns. What types of deviant arousal patterns do they have? Fantasies, pornography. What leads up to the sexual offending? Their cognitive distortions, like the example that I gave you. What is their belief system? A lot of good work. I'm going to look at a study a little bit later here, but Gene Abel, A-B-E-L, you should look at his work. He goes back to the 1970s, and it hasn't changed. He was one of the first researchers to look at cognitive distortions of sex offenders, and it's a very important part of assessment and treatment. The family context, what are the relationships about within the family that is either triggering or supporting, condoning the sexual offending by an adolescent? And then, of course, the risk of reoffending. Risk assessment tools, however, there's no empirically validated methods for accurately classifying risk among adolescent sex offenders. Three of the more common ones that are used, even though they're not empirical, is the JSO, the PFS, and the ERASER. And you can pretty much get either any of those or one of those. And I like the JSO in particular as part of the interview process. I would tell you that. I also like to use the JSO to measure effectiveness in treatment. So not only do we need a comprehensive assessment, but I also think we need to reassess every 6 months when we're working with adolescents and their families. Assessments are culminated into a written report, and the outcomes of the assessment is really focusing on two things, and that's to provide recommendations for treatment and to provide recommendations for placement. Placement has to do with, do we recommend that this adolescent go into residential treatment, that he remain within the community, and if so, should she or he remain within the family, or should, they be placed into kinship care or foster care? So placement becomes very critical in working with adolescents. The assessment process itself is going to include a social and family history, interview with sexually offending youth, interview with parents, and an interview with the victims. There are those of us, not me, but people who work within this field of sexual offending, who don't interview the victim. And I think we are missing an extraordinary piece of information, a very important piece of information, when we don't interview the victim. Review of arrest records and other information, criminal investigation, interview with probation. And that really should take place, by the way, the interview with the victim and the interview with the criminal justice system, prior to your first meeting with the adolescent. Why is that? Because you're going to get a lot of good information, and when the lies are told and the deception is provided, you have the information in which to challenge that. Okay? In a very matter-of-fact kind of way.